So, I'm afraid that repeatedly and shamefully misspelled because name was. So, I have a ring fix once and for all, then we have the A, which is term A, which is the main module, and they are the electron. And in addition, there are two maps that make the following exact sequence. So all this collection is called Kikali Kikali. And the maps respect the structure they are supposed. And also sigma plays a role in how these structures are interrelated. So we would like to classify. I'm doing it for the reason that...
Sorry, TA is what? The algebra of
the relations. I'm doing this for the reason that later on we will look at vertex of projects. And their classification will be similar, slightly more complicated there. So, to classify, we have to decide what morphisms are. So, a morphism from one such as to another is a map that respects the two structures. So the A module and the other structure. But it should also respect this thing so that it's not just A and B we're dealing with. We have those two sequences. Likewise for B. And so this map must make this whole diagram commutative, such that this whole thing is commutative. Natural thing, isn't it? So that, of course, defines a category of such algebraic. And you immediately see that this, let me call it here, category of algebraics, and you immediately see that this is a group point, meaning that all morphisms are isomorphisms. That's because of this obvious observation that we even mentioned last time. So you have a map of two things, both are filtered, here is a two-step filtration, and so if you have a map of filtered spaces that induces an isomorphism on the graded space, actual inequality in this case, then the map itself is an isomorphism. Right?
So all Picardi algebraics are actually isomorphic, but isomorphic.
No, not all of them. But if there is a map, this is necessarily an isomorphism. That's what makes a category group. Yeah, this is important. Some of them aren't. We are about to obtain an non-trivial classification of objects up to isomorphism. So now we have everything ready for classification, and to proceed, I will assume that say TA is free as a name object. It's a natural assumption. After all, our aim is to do things on a smooth variety, and locally shaped like that are free. So if T is free, then this splits. So those exact sequences all split. So we can therefore pick a split. So for the sake of simplicity, we will always present a given E. This is an assumption throughout. A is a, it's an affine ring. Actually, an affine ring of a smooth affine variety. I mentioned it at the beginning.
It's finitely generated.
A is automatically finitely generated, because T sub A is
curly A.
Curly A, yes. As a name module, it's finitely generated. It's this, and this is finitely generated. Generated algebra. So, we're given such a thing, and there is an example. On such an A module, there is always a structure of curly algebra. You can think of having started with a trivial such algebraic, where the bracket is simply a loop bracket of vector functions. What else can we add to?
So on T is a liberated, but on A it's just zero.
No, on A that's as a that's part of the definition. TA acts on A as it's supposed. That's by derivation. That's part of the definition. So this is fixed. Q is the only thing that's not fixed. Let me write it and then perhaps that will remove your question. So the most general bracket is like this. If you pick an element here, then you know how it brackets with this as to bracketing two such elements. Let's simply compare whatever we can get with the standard Lie bracket. From definition, it follows that any bracket is like this plus something which is an element of A, and it depends on psi and A. That's the consequence of this thing fitting an exact signal.
It is a bilinear.
Yeah, I will discuss exactly what it is, but at the moment it's just a theoretic notation. A bracket two vector fields, in the most general situation, is the usual bracket, that's because you have the morphism of Lie algebras, plus something that belongs to the kernel of sigma, and that's an element of A.
But in addition, you have to say what is bracket two elements from A straight and of A straight.
I said it's a Lie bracket, a standard Lie bracket. Bracket of derivation.
No. C and eta lie in TA.
This is again notations throughout.
I understand. But also in addition, you have to say what is bracket.
No, I don't think
it. What is the bracket on straight A? Because you have bracket on curly A, right?
Yes. Curve A has been presented like this.
It's direct sum of two more.
Yes.
Not to define bracket on curly A, you have to define not only bracket on T A.
Yes.
But also on straight A, and bracket of element of straight A is T A.
You mean this?
Yeah.
Oh, this by definition. That's part of the definition. I didn't mention it explicitly, but it's in your VC. You didn't study the notes.
And bracket of two elements from straight A is zero.
Yes. Yeah, it's also part of the definition.
Yeah, it's true.
All right, so what conditions should this function of two variables, alpha, satisfy? So first of all, we're dealing with A modules. So the A module structure implies that plus this, it's easy to verify. It implies that alpha is A by V. The bracket is not bilinear, but it is not bilinear by something fixed via this. That's part of the definition. So whatever you add must be A bilinear. Immediate consequence of
this. It's linear simply. It's linear and straight.
Yeah. So but then the thing is a V algebra. What does this imply? Well, it should be anti-symmetric. That implies that F is anti-symmetric. So if you have a form of this thing, that's O bilinear and then it's symmetric, more or less by definition, at least in the case when T is free, as we agreed, it means that alpha is a differential form. By definition. The algebra also means that this thing is satisfies each other. That to be means, of course, psi eta plus equals zero. But if you think a little bit about it, you will.
I presuppose.
Say it again?
I presuppose.
Boston?
Boston.
Close.
Well, yes, of course. So if you write, you will get something like this. That, by definition, or by the famous formula, perhaps, can be taken as a definition of the Durand differential. This implies that the alpha of the three form is zero. So all the discussion culminates in saying that alpha is close to four. So let me know temporarily.
Yeah, only the two is what's called Taylor differential.
But when T is free, then it can be very simply described as
zero.
In general, this is not, it's not quite what I said. But all right, so if we denote by, I don't know, it's just a temporary notation, by A of alpha, alpha is close to 4. This, because we have to it. Then we claim that, this calculation shows that any, because we have to it, is equivalent to A alpha for some such value. So this is object, at least up to after isomorphism. Now morphism. So let's discuss the space of maps from one such to another. you can probably guess what the result is. So I erased this the two exact sequences, but immediately realized that you have two such objects. They, as A module, they are the same, so they're fixed in realization. And but the map doesn't have to preserve the splitting. Not to, but say splitting. So the only possibility is to map the A goes to A vector fields modulo A to themselves, I mean, the identity. So the most general thing that can occur is that an element, a derivation goes to itself plus some function. That, of course, depends on psi. And now you, in the spirit of our previous discussion, discuss the properties that beta must have. It's beta is a linear. That, of course, is more than output. So it means that, by definition, it means that it's simply a one form. So we have to study the consequences. So a map like that is automatically morphic A modules. That's all. So really the question is, what conditions should beta satisfy so that the map is a map of a morphic real? So beta defines a morphic lambda. A morphic if and only if up to the sign, the one differential of beta is the difference of the two forms up to an overall sign. We'll look in a second. Let me write this down. Let me call this map F cap. So why is this correct? So what is it that we have to do? It looks like an exercise for beginning the algebra theory. So we want to check that if we take f of psi, f of theta, and bracket them according to what it should be in the image, so using alpha 2, then the result should be as if we first did the bracket in the source of the graph, and then apply it.
Is that curly? Yeah.
Curly what?
It's tilde. Yeah, tilde.
Well, I wrote to help. So. And then you simply plug in the use the definition and you obtain the result. So phi of psi is psi plus theta, psi f of theta is theta plus beta, theta, and here it's as follows. We first do this, obtaining psi theta plus f of psi theta, and applying f to this results in getting a beta of really bracket. So this must be equal to this. When after you compute, you of course easily get something like psi beta eta minus eta weight itself. When I write like this, by the way, it means that this is a function and I differentiate it along something. There will be brackets on that too, they will go away. And so this equals, well, I need to say, yeah, but there is another term here, of course, alpha 2, psi 8. So that's the left-hand side, and the right-hand side will be, it's there, alpha 1, psi 8. And indeed, what it means is that alpha 1 minus alpha 2, if I move alpha 2 to the right and collect all the betas on the left, we will get on the left exactly the formula for the differential psi beta eta minus eta beta psi minus beta of the graph. And that by definition of the differential of beta on psi and eta. Yes, promise. So the conclusion of all of this is any object is isomorphic to what I denoted as A of alpha and the space of morphing from one to another is the set of beta such that the beta is alpha 1 minus alpha 2. From which, of course, it follows that the set of isomorphic classes is precisely you want that the objects are labeled, so to say, after isomorphic by two forms, and they are isomorphic whenever the form is exact. So we move out. So that, of course, is what's known as the second derived homology. Now we would like to put all of this on a variety.
Affine.
No, arbitrary. Arbitrary, but smooth. This is straightforward. The whole thing is to do the local, discuss the local situation, but otherwise I will not even write it. So because the algebraic is a vertical hearing shape, which it's a correct module, and the algebra, just as before, plus the fact that it fits on the net in a specified way. Where the two maps satisfy the same condition that we discussed. excitement is Tibetan. All right. So let's classify then things on a variety. So how many, let me put this in front of you, how many such objects are there? So what you do, of course, you consider a fine enough cover, fine enough, meaning that open, meaning that I worked under this condition that this thing was free. So I said fine enough, meaning that on each UI, this is a free module with functions.
But isn't it automatic if X is smooth?
Yes, X is smooth.
But then this will be automatic if you know. Ah, it's small. You have
you have to see fusion.
The small circle becomes.
When we discuss this circle, you have to throw away something, then you will get.
In this case, for this example,
you throw away X equals zero.
It is not free.
So yeah, it's not free.
But
all right. So what is that? You need to define such an A on X if this is given. Well, first of all, you need to define whatever A is. You need what eventually will be the algebraic the space of sections over UI. But for that we have classification, and so picking this means choosing
in the definition. You need to put that tau x acts on the on function as derivation.
This is all part of the definition. I think I gave a full complete definition last time. Maybe I forgot something, but yes. It's part of the definition. So it means that for each R, you will have to choose a closed to form of R. Now, of course, so you have a bunch of such things. You have UI and you have UJ. So you have a alpha I here and alpha j there. Now you have to put them together, have to glue them, meaning that over intersection it's quasi-coherent shape. So you have you take the thing living there, restricted here, likewise this, and you have to be sure that they are isomorphic of the intersection. Furthermore, you have to fix such an isomorphism. That is interpreted as a gluing function. In view of our classification, what it means is, so the second gluing means choosing on the intersections one form, such that, so that's a tool to identify the two things, meaning that d beta ij equals alpha I minus alpha j, I mean on the intersection. Gluing must be transitive. So we Yeah, it's like equivalence relation. If you put three things together, then the result should be the same. So if you have the one triple intersections, okay, so if you live here, then going from I to J and then from K to K is the same as going from I directly to K. So what it means is you can do it. Yes, and I'll keep from my notes. It means that the co-cycle condition beta J K minus beta I K plus beta IK equals zero. It's easier to read like this, but beta IK equals beta IJ plus beta JK. So just what I said, going from I to K directly is the same as doing it in two steps, from I to J and then from J to K. So what do these two conditions mean? So all this thing means that so this bunch of data, the collection of tokens and the collection of data on the intersection define an element of the first cycle of dimension one, on X with coefficients in the complex, in the truncated Durham complex. Let me explain. So this is technically called the co-chains, or the first co-cycle in the corresponding hyperhomology. So what I really mean...
Are using the check or check?
Check, yes. In one direction we have check, in another, that's what I mean, and in another, the round. So let me draw a picture and people...
And what's the difference if omega 1 x goes to omega 2? Close. Ah, close.
So here is a picture that depicts all of this. So these alternating sums are Czech differentials. So we have, and then there is independently at around this range. So let's see how it works. So I have this complex. And I think of this as sitting in degree zero and this in degree one. So this, I think of this as the Perron direction. And so my alpha has one index. So from the check point of view, it has degree zero. But from the Durham point of view, it has degree one. So this bunch is the check coachy. Betas have two indices, so that's the check direction. So in the check direction, that's degree one. And so this is a bunch of beta sub IJ. So the condition that this alternating sum equals zero means that this map, and it's defined exactly by that formula. So D check beta IJ is a two check chain, so it depends on three indices, IJ, A. And that's the formula. So whatever one chain is, that's the check differential. My condition is that the result is zero. Now let us look at this equality. First, I take beta ij and look derived. The result is not necessarily zero, but it equals to that alternating sum, which, of course, for the same reason, is the check differential applied to this zero check. And finally, the transitivity condition. No, not the transitivity. These are closed. So the check differential of this is zero. So this simple picture simply means that the whole bunch is a cocycle with my conventions on the degree. It's a cocycle of degree one because I shifted everything. So that's objects. Which objects are isomorphic? Now, of course, you'll tell me isomorphism. So being an object means being a co-chain. Being isomorphic means being exact. So an object like this, for example, is trivial if it's a total differential applied to a zero chain. A zero chain is simply something sitting, gamma. No. So it has chef degree zero, so it's gamma I,
So
it's a function that has
function,
and it has only one index, and this thing is differential of that bunch, means that beta ij equals
is it 1/4, is it gamma I?
What?
Is it gamma I, is it exactly 1/4?
Yeah, it's 1/4, but zero, not even 1/4, really. Interesting. That might be. Otherwise, this thing wouldn't work. So beta ij is supposed to be gamma I minus gamma j, and alpha I is supposed to be the sum of gamma I. If you think about my classification, you immediately see that this all makes perfect sense. It just simply means that by choosing, so to say, trivialization, changing trivialization, the whole thing becomes constant. A plus A that was there all along with the leaf wrapper. So the conclusion of this great discussion simply is the isomorphism classes of the Carle algebraics on X and above is precisely the first hyperhomology for maps with coefficient in the truncated the wrong complex.
This is called hyperhomology.
Yeah, but of course, there are two differentials. Check and round. In the fine situation, you don't need check, you just do the round, as we did previously. But on the manifold, you have to, on the right, you have to. Example. Yes, sure, there are techniques of complete sections, spectral sequences. You can start with the DRAM. I'll show you even the computation, a very trivial one, but.
So you have a bicomplex.
Yeah, yeah.
Because there are differential, we could check.
Yeah, 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 that's what, yeah, of course, that's what first question.
And hyper means that you take, I think, the sum.
Yeah, 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 hyper means that I'm dealing, there is a general definition, but in particular, you can compute it using a bicomplex. And by definition, hypercohomology will be the total, the cohomology of the
this
total.
The sum of the sum of the
system. Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's what I
said.
Does
anybody say? Ah, yes, erasure. Ah, you want erasure?
Erasure, yes. No, erasure.
Ah, yes.
It's wrong.
Just
ah, I always do that.
Also, the word is an erasure.
Hmm?
This thing there is also an erasure.
Is it?
Yeah.
I was
so
afraid.
Even
I was
afraid
to touch that.
Because
the
other one is not.
Remember where we started the discussion of algebras of twisted differential operator, that you can consider I haven't yet defined them yet, but you can consider algebras of twisted differential operators by picking a line bound and considering differential operators acting on a line bound. In particular, we looked at an example of CP1, where we had this great collection of not so much line bounds as sections of a line bound, sheaves of sections of a line bound, OM. So let's see how that computation fits what I did. So in the case of CP1, that's one dimensional. There are four pi omega 2s. That's zero. So the group becomes simply so omega 1 maps to zero. Therefore, it should be. In principle, omega 1 closed, but the whole thing is one-dimensional, so any one form is automatically closed. So it boils down to something very straightforward. And that's well known what that is. It's one-dimensional. And you can choose a representative by picking one of the two coordinates, x and y, and considering, so to say, that differential of the ball. So, therefore, in this case, the result becomes that the set of isomorphisms classes of the algebraics is C. What exactly does it? What does it mean in real life? What kind of a Picardly algebraoid does a choice of a complex number choose? If you think about it, remember there were two things, alphas and betas. Alphas classify brackets locally. A two form is a two to introduce a non-trivial bracket, different from the Lie bracket. In this case, there is no such thing. Therefore, locally, any Picardly algebraic on CP1 is the same as the usual one, function plus vector fused with the Lie bracket. The only thing that can change is a gluing function. What's the gluing function that...
Sorry, what do you mean by dx over x? This would give us a...
That check call cycle.
Yes, but
that's one form of the intersection.
Ah, this is just an intersection.
Yeah, yeah. You have C, C, X, Y, and the intersection, you can divide. So on the intersection, you have the X and X. It's a well known fact. You can easily, it's a movementic computation. So, if you go over definitions, you will immediately realize how. Lambda dx dx affects the gluing. The gluing, if lambda is zero, then as we discussed, the X gets identified with, let me do it the other way around, contradicting my previous computations. I hope you forgive me. That's how to say the case when lambda equals zero. An arbitrary lambda, the Bloom function, by definition, is a composition. You first do this. Remember, it was psi goes to psi plus beta on psi. So what you have to do is to take this thing and add lambda dx on x, evaluate it on minus x squared. Dx, dx, dx mu 1, and so the result is minus lambda x. That's exactly the formula we obtained from the differential operators on a shift interpretation. And it was up to a sign is, of course, a nightmare, but up to a sign was exactly what we obtained. So that's the scientific, rather simply different explanation of this thing. You will notice that's a rather fundamental observation, that this language is more general than this one. So
in particular, lambda is not necessarily.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to say. So you can think of this as the definition of differential operators acting on O lambda. But of course, this thing only makes sense when lambda is an integer. However, the algebra makes sense always for the reason that you have to do the D of the log, and what was power for the line bundle becomes a factor coefficient for the algebra, and that of course has important consequences. I will finish by returning just for a second. I actually wanted to do it even in general, but I don't feel like doing so. So I'll just mention the VSO2 generalization of Davidson and Bernstein's localization for SL2 when the central character so you think of lambda as a highest weight, so central character is lambda minus 1 or plus 1. So now suppose lambda is m, and it's maybe plus, I'm not sure. So you just compute. So lambda should be at least non-negative. What I'm saying is that, as we discussed, so this was all, so to say, the algebra, so a generalization of the notion of the algebra of vector derivations. But where is the algebra of twisted differential operators? So if you have a Picard the algebraic A, then you can define that there is a notion of the universal enveloping algebra of an algebraic as opposed to a real algebra. It is pretty straightforward. So you A, whatever else it is a real algebra. So you can consider the U of A. Usual universal envelope in algebra. This is a wrong object as far as algebraics go, because algebraics, it's very important, and we'll see it even more in the case of a vertex algebra. It's not just a Lie algebra, it has a multiplication, although it is only partially defined. You can multiply vector fields and functions, or functions and functions, but you cannot multiply vector fields. So, but part of the usual kind of associated multiplication is there already. So this is a device to define multiplication. So where both multiplications coincide, where both multiplications are defined, they should coincide. That's that condition. So having started with this, we define what we want by taking this and then quotient it out by the obvious idea. So first of all, any universal envelope has its own unit. But A contains the ring, and it has a unit of its own. They should be identified. And so it goes. You have one function and another. But the cross will stand for multiplication that is part of the universal enveloping of the layout, where F and G are elements of the ring, either LX or A, depending on your situation. And likewise, if you multiply a function and the vector field here, the result will be the same as it was before. I discussed this thing briefly in the case of the usual kind of zero Picard algebra, like A plus TA, which gives rise to the usual algebra of the French problem. It's an analogous construction. So, by definition, so an algebra of a sheaf of associatives OX algebras is called an algebra of twisted differential operators if it equals universal enveloping of some Picard Lie algebra.
What is this object, U curly of A? It is...
So just as I said, it's a real...
It's a flawed abstraction.
Associative algebra, nothing else.
Ah, that's it. It's just associative.
Yes, associative unit of associative algebra. It's an algebraic analog of the universal enveloping of the wheels. The difference is that where is an algebra, it is different from... Lie algebra is different from Lie algebra. It's that it carries partially defined associative multiplication. And the construction must respect it. So we have to impose some extra conditions.
What in partially defined? This is the associative algebra.
Yes. Take an element F there. You see, it's like a Lie algebra. Think of suppose A is just A curly plus derivation. The bracket is the usual Lie bracket. This is a Lie algebra, but it is also an A module. Forget about the A module structure. Then you can define this thing. This thing. If you do it, you will immediately see that the result is different from the usual algebra of differential operators. In that, this Lie algebra has, for example, a function and the vector field. If you multiply it here, you won't get the corresponding vector field there. So this is too big an object.
Yes.
We have to preserve it. So we just quotient out those objects identifications. So if you do it for that standard example, you will get a usual algebra of French level.
It's also
true. Yes, yes. So, last sentence. Remember I told you that there is a one sentence definition of a, of an algebra of twisted differential operators. Yes. I will now return to that. So you will not. So, you know, universal enveloping carry canonical filtration, and the greater object is easy to describe. It's a commutative personal. So this is, this carries over to this case. So think about the following. It's very easy. So this thing is filtered. And the corresponding graded object is absolutely canonically isomorphic to the standard Poisson algebra, symmetric algebra of vector fields. In fact, the two things, the two definitions are equivalent. Saying that d twisted is your A for some A is equivalent to saying that d twisted is a filtered algebra such that the corresponding graded is commutative and Poisson and isomorphic to this as a Poisson of
filtered algebra, just by subalgebra.
Hmm?
By some subalgebra. Filtered, you mean?
No, 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 you have to find the filtration. I haven't defined it. That's homework,
but it's all homocyclic. By what?
But by T. It's, you start doing products, so the degree 1 will be simply A, degree 0 is simply A, degree 1, so you just count the number of vector fields. That's a true phase. That's
the number of elements from T.
Mm-hmm. All right. I think it's a good time to make it. They discovered something like this, but in their language, in a much more general, a much more complicated situation. And their word is chiral, and that's how it migrated to what we've been doing. So I will be working with honest
word. You know, actually, physicists call chiral algebra.
Yes, physicists call this chiral, but for some reason, mathematicians never did. So why is that? You don't know? Why word is never used? I wasn't. Sorry, I missed your.
No,
I wasn't
okay,
here.
Right.
Okay. So, logically, a natural thing to do would be for me to start developing a theory that is very parallel to what I explained. What I explained TDO the way I did precisely because it's this chain of thought, this line of argument that can be adjusted to the vertex algebra situation. But I thought that pedagogically, and because Vitti is explaining exactly something like he was explaining, pedagogically it's better to do it differently. Better to do it the way we stumbled upon such algebras, I'm afraid even to think when it was many, many years ago. So let me start. So I'll show you an example, and then I will argue that this example has a vertex version here of differential operator. So I haven't defined. So instead of things like this, I will be writing things like this. And I will start with the case when my A is just a polynomial. And so I'm working on so that the variety is the line. I haven't defined that. So this is, for the moment, it's just a fine annotation. For the following space, it's actually an infinite a polynomial algebra on infinitely many variables. Xn dn minus 1 n being non-negative. Now I want to make this polynomial thing intermodule over a real. I don't have any reasonable notation for real test, right? Graphic agent for no reason at all. So I'm writing x and d, and indeed I'm trying to hint at this having to do with this x and d having to do with ddf. At the moment there is no direct relation, it's just notation. So the same will be true for the algebra. So its generators will be x and d sub m, and there will be c and m is not to the integer. By the way, in short, I told you that I haven't defined anything like this, it's just a notation, but what I'm about to define is well known as the beta gamma system. And I'm practically certain that in Victor's text, this vertex algebra has a special name, different perhaps from beta gamma, but I forgot what it is.
It's called just three super family.
No, it's all it's all purely even.
Yes, and it's like space A, just you.
All right, so anyway, so this is some. It wasn't mentioned, this algebra wasn't explicitly, hasn't been explicitly mentioned here, right?
It was denoted, sorry, I apologize.
All right, but I won't be using your notation because I'll get confused. So after all, my point of view will be.
This way, this d chiral is just polynomials, there are no relations. Or you put something.
No, that's what it is. At the moment, it's just this.
But this algebra can
it agrees with my notation. So if d, if I wrote something like this, that would be wild algebra. So it will contain only polynomials in x. There will go also derivatives. It's not a shift, it's a chiral algebra.
No, I mean xn and dn minus 1, they can meet or?
I was right. That's a polynomial algebra.
Yeah, and here, there are some relations.
Yeah. This is a real algebra. And the relations are C is central, and then you immediately realize that this space is is naturally an A module. In fact, it's an induced module. Let me not define what A plus is, you can easily guess from that notation. C, of course, acts as multiplication by 1. So C is part of A plus and it acts by 1.
Okay. A plus is just D.
Whatever is not there. So some of them are here and some aren't. Those that aren't, probably you don't know that A minus. Ah, but that's a disaster. Okay, A minus. Is it better? Let's see. That's a very special example from Victor's last lecture, I suspect. So I simply, of course, one that's an element of my polynomial ring is the vacuum. The field associated to X naught will be this. There is no D naught there. There is only D minus 1. And I need the derivation. T, what is your notation? T is a so it's a, you know what, I can write simply a formula. Can be expressed in terms of the layout of elements. If I'm not terribly mistaken, something like this. Minus m, xm, d minus m minus 1. The sum of these indices is never 0, so normal ordering is not necessary. I'm not sure any kind of algebra structure was introduced by Vitya in this context, but of course people who know something about vertex algebras will recognize in this expression a particular Virasoro algebra element, exactly the one that you usually use to define.
Yeah, I can't explain it yet, but I think.
But anyway, you here is an explicit formula, and you will see that it acts in a natural way, more or less exactly what you expect to do from a derivation on the algebra. Xn will go to. I painfully computed this. I hope I didn't make any mistake. My n is not what Victor denotes by n in brackets, it's rather n related to. Shifted by conformal weight. And this thing is
you mean it's
it's graded.
T, you mean T says X and
yeah. So an exercise. Maybe it's silly, since it was a particular case of what I've done last time by Victor, but probably some of you may find this useful to verify that the locality. So I'm used to writing delta V minus delta, as Victor did in earlier edition of his pen. So I will continue doing so. I guess Victor writes delta V, comma.
So as well as this is vertex algebra, which I denoted by f of a, where a is even vector space, two dimensional. And the bilinear
form
is 0,
1, 1. Yes, something like that. So the conditions of, I think you previously called it reconstruction theorem. Last time I think you called it extension theorem, if I'm not mistaken.
Right, said one thing today.
So we are local, there is this T, you can verify the brackets of T with those agrees with this action, and so that gives a structure of a vertex itself. So my claim will be to see step by step that this is some kind of a vertex analog of the usual algebra of differential operators on the line. It's convenient for me to have some kind of a pictorial description of this. So, as I mentioned already, everything here is graded. Layout is graded. The degree of A sub n is n, I believe. And A is either x or d. And so, the algebra I introduced is also graded. It's a module, and so placing 1 in dimension 0 will give you a grading. And then I'll grade this to make sure it's a good notation. And so the whole thing goes in layers. There is level 0, 1, 2, and so little 0 conformably 0 if you have a space of all polynomials in C of X naught. At all the other levels, you will have a free C of X naught algebras generated by X minus 1, D minus 1 in conformably 1 and in conformably 2. So it will spawn X minus to X minus 1 squared, etc. D minus. So you can easily see the size of what the size of this space is. So I don't have much evidence at the moment to claim that this is some sort of an algebra of differential operators in the vertex setting, but the reason for thinking so will become apparent as we proceed. At the moment, if we believe in this, so the thing is...
Sorry, I cannot think. Delta 0 is degree 0.
Say it again.
Delta 0.
D is
0, delta 0.
Yeah, it's degree 0, right? Yeah, but it's not there, it's an error rating operator.
Ah,
delta 0 is ddx naught. So it acts there, but it itself it's not there. So at a very naive level, this whole thing looks like, I insist on reservation. Not really. If you write it like, you will later on see, if you write it like this, then you can see obviously action of this algebra, but this action doesn't render itself naturally in terms of intrinsic vortex algebra terms. So when we are done, we will get something that is not a module over some commutative thing, but at least at the moment it looks like so. And if we want to get a shift, then the first question that arises, can we localize? Now, what do I mean by that? Well, it's like going from C of X naught to a algebra of fractions. That is to say, we want to get a singular space. And then, nothing is going to happen to generators. But it's the algebra of functions that will be replaced by the space of fractions. But here is a space. And if we want to think of this as a localization of a vertex algebra, the first question that arises is there, where that here, is there a vertex algebra structure? Look at what we have. Operators di, whether I positive or negative, naturally act there. So do xi, and so does this operator. So all of this is obvious. It's somewhat less obvious in the case of di, where I is non-negative, and t. So the reason they act is because they are derivations in any sense of the word. For example, this whole thing was defined as a polynomial ring. So these operators are derivations. For example, look at t. It's given by this infinite sum of derivations. So it's a derivation. Therefore, it acts on fractions. So what's the crucial issue then? Here it is. So is there a vertex algebra structure? So that all of this boils down to this. Suppose f is x naught. So what's the field attached to 1 on x naught? So in other words, what meaning 1 on x z can be given, where x of z is this quantum field that's part of the vertex of the structure. That's just a symbol. Does it make sense? We were discussing this with Tariq in Bonn, and when we hit this roadblock, I think the project would have died at once had I not spoken to Borifei a couple of months before. We were speaking of something quite different. But for one reason or another, I forgot what, Borifei explained to me exactly that. So he wrote, you know, so what says he? 1 divided by this sum is, well, says Boyer, extract x naught, collect all the rest of the summations of the summation set, and then take x not well, then use the geometric.
You probably want to write here x with geometric. Is that left?
Just and then simply use a geometric power, the sum of the geometric series thing of this thing as a small x. The result will be, well, everybody knows what the result is. 1 on x naught sum. And varying from 0 as frame change. The same, of course, can be done for an arbitrary power. It's a rather, at least I found it, rather strange. Various manipulations with infinite sums are, of course, a hallmark of Markov algorithm, but so this, at least to me, looks completely alien. And yet, it's easy to verify. I will deliver it for those interested as an exercise. So, that's about defining field. It's precisely because, by the way, I made a mistake. If I take out x naught, then 1 on x naught is. But.
No, but you need to
convert it. I took out x naught.
No, you put it. No.
So it's 1 plus 1 on x naught. So
it is 1 plus some x0 divided. Ah, yeah, each of them should be divided.
So, exercise. This graph does define 2 is local 2D, and the formula is natural. So it will be minus 1 on, like we teach our students, except delta function appears. Once this is done, it doesn't take much imagination to extend this form, an arbitrary function of x, or of x naught, if you like. So this is the field that we decided to attach to the function 1 on x naught. So for any function of x, it doesn't even have to be rational. Rational or analytic or even smooth, infinitely differential of x. We define the field by mimicking that formula. The formula used the Taylor series expansion. So the nth derivative with respect to x is times this famous epsilon. So some r distance from zero. It makes sense as a field. It's very easy to verify. If F is part, so what I'm thinking is, so you either do this, and that's what I will actually need. But you can go either all rational function or class of analytic function, whatever you like. So whatever ring you have. If F is an element of this ring, you define a field associated to the ring by an alleged stateful correspondent that we're trying to define by this formula. And
then?
Hmm?
Then?
Say it again?
The last part.
Power.
I found it. And again, a similar computation will show. It's a little bit straightforward that the field attached to D bracket thus defined field.
Sorry, you have put 1 over x0 in front or not?
It's the type of formula, yeah, it's just
on the right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Of not the sum, but sum multiplied by 1 over x0.
Yeah, I'm confused.
Yeah, both formula, yeah, 1 over x0.
Yeah, so it agrees. It's the same formula. It's the same formula. Yeah, yeah, of course, it's the same formula. You will have there are two, one and x naught. You will have one.
Inside.
Yeah, so after the bracket.
It's
to make it, what's wrong?
The inside.
Yeah. So
besides,
we were wondering if there's a
1
over
x0
multiplying the whole sum.
No, there's nothing there. It's agree with that formula. Okay. That's the meaning of that formula. This is the meaning of that formula. Okay. Just of a run expansion. There I obtained it by using geometric series formula. And here I use the type of series formula. That's all. So that formula should be this in the case when f of x is 1 on f.
Yeah.
I'm just writing the Taylor series. So it will be df dx. By the way, there is also this famous T operator. What do you think the formula is going to be? T bracket, if it's like that. Can you guess? So, dx, x of w, and then expand out. As it should, for a usual field, T bracket X W. So the end, of course, is this. So all of this brings us back into the situation of the strong reconstruction theory. So you have a space. We have a collection of itself. Probably this was called, I missed this lecture, shamefully, but I wasn't in the country when that was given. So I suspect this is what Victor yesterday called extension theorem, and then in Victor's first edition, beginning steps, and thank you very much. This is called, I guess, strong reconstruction theory. So we have all the prerequisites. We have a space, and on top, living on top, is a ring. Mostly of interest to me, I will be mostly interested in the algebraic situation, so in fractions like this. But just as I said, it can be analytic functions on some domain, or even infinity functions somewhere. And otherwise, the whole thing looks like a free module over this. And so it goes. So from then down, from here down, there's no change. And we have attached fields as before to these elements. And now we have attached a field. So if I have, I don't know, a G there, that I have explained how to attach a field to an element like this. And the bunch of formulas listed as exercises is exactly the prerequisite. There is, of course, this is a unit of ring, as a unit. The unit will be a deductive method. It's annihilated by T, as it was previously. And so all this together shows that it's about itself. So all this means that this room defines the perfect spectral structure on this space. So, the construction is very natural. You can go over it and people realize that having defined the vertex algebra for each such localization means that we've got a shift on the line.
A vertical structure on these polynomials which you
localized.
Yes.
Yeah, so now it is absolutely obvious that not again.
Just above you.
On top of you. Over there.
So, if you pick a C, and for any subset, we define that vertex algebra, that we attach to each set, this space will be vertex algebra defined. It looks like this. It's a C of X naught. And then, of course, the polynomial. It's quite clear that this defines a sheet of vertex algebras on set. So that was first part. How to well, I have 5 minutes to go, right? can I continue? First item on the program was the second, first was localized, second was now blue. On CP1, of course, that's our main example that we are stuck with. So I again start playing this already familiar game. So CP1, two charts. Cell C star at B intersection, coordinates X and Y equal to 1 of X. So we have two copies of the same algebra. So to say X, dx. Remember, this dx is no longer the honest dx. This is, depending on the circumstances, if I put an index, this is an element of the corresponding Lie algebra, or so this is informal, so I guess you know what it's a symbolic notation. So x, d lying here, or y, dy lying there. These are just two copies, they just have to distinguish between them. Lying at the intersection are two copies of the localized algebra where I deal with the run of the normal rings in either x or y. So now we have two copies of the same algebra. But we want to identify them. But we identify them not in a trivial way, not by identifying x with y, but rather in the way that's suggested by geometry. We identify x with y inverse. So here is what we want to do. So I have, what is the right move? I guess t. Chiral C X X inverse and another such algebra. They are of course isomorphic, but we need an isomorphism. So what field is what we want? An isomorphism that lifts the classic assignment, one of course goes to one, but x goes, or rather x not in this context, goes to y not inverse. I don't have much time. Let me explain how this can be done. It is rather amusing. So what I need really is a map from this space to that space. It's keeping in mind the reconstruction theorem. It's much more telling to try to write it informally in terms of field. So I will say, where does the field go? So where will the field X of Z go? Well, this is not up to discussion. It goes to 1 on y of z inverse. How about dx? Or if you forget about x, it's ddx, so it's supposed to go to minus y squared dy. What sense can we make out of this as a field? Well, of course, you write y of z squared divided. Now, writing expressions like that, as Peter explained in vertex algebra, is fraught. You have to do something to make sense out of it. And it's actually up to art, and you will see soon that some choices indeed have to be made. An obvious choice is to use normal ordering. Well, if it's two of them, Victor explained last time, if it's three or more, the typical thing is...
Well, this I didn't say, but I will say it next time. So you're moving from right to left?
Yes, like this. there's nothing fundamental about it. It's a matter of change. Actually,
no, but then you should put BC in dots.
I did. It fails, by the way. So, but this is what we're trying to do. Will it work? You know, I don't want to deprive you of the pleasure of discovering this on your own. Think about it, and I'll give you the answer on Monday.